I think is expressed in the hidden word, I love thy creation, therefore I created thee, wherefore do thou love me, that I may name thy name and fill thy soul with the spirit of life. So there's this also idea in the hidden words of our creation by God being, you know, God sort of loved us before we were even created. So there was this, there is a mystical circle that was just waiting to be completed, and our lives, spiritually realizing our lives to the fullest extent, means completing that circle of consciousness, that and closing that that circle. Going back briefly to what the Bab said, he says that this divine must remember himself or mention himself, and the word remembrance and mention actually in Arabic, zekr, is this, it's the same word, so it's difficult to translate because you could translate it either way. But he says the divine, you know, mentions himself to himself, and he says, and some people have called this the soul. So out of nowhere, he takes this, he takes what we thought was our personal slice of the universe, you know, our possession, you know, if we possess anything, that spark of the divine, which is ours, and the Bab just very casually says, even that's not ours. You know, even that, in the end, when you pull away the shrouds of the self, and what you're left with is that spark of the divine, he says, that spark of the divine is really a mode of the divine self-remembrance, which I think connects to Baha'u'llah's, you know, point at the end of the Seven Valleys, which is the highest stage of the wayfarer is the stage of self-annihilation, this valley or this station or city of true poverty and absolute nothingness. But it's very interesting, actually, that Baha'u'llah has different ways of describing the spiritual journey in different of his mystical writings. And this is where we're kind of historically a bit... our hands are a bit tied behind our back when we're trying to understand Baha'u'llah, because we only have about 5% of his writings translated into English at this time. And somewhere in the remaining 95%, there are other mystical tablets, and some of these are in the process of being finalized and published during these couple of years that are coming up. And among these fresh writings that are to be published are further mystical tablets in which Baha'u'llah gives different takes on the mystical journey. One of them we actually already have, and it was published about 10 years ago in the book Gems of Divine Mysteries, which very much follows the Seven Valleys in the overall schema. It starts with search, it goes through love, skips knowledge, but then it goes straight to unity, and there's contentment and wonderment. And self-annihilation or true poverty and absolute nothingness. But in Gems of Divine Mysteries, Baha'u'llah takes it two more steps. And in the next step, one recovers immortality. So the step beyond, there's a stage beyond the seventh valley in this Gems of Divine Mysteries. And that stage is, after Fana comes Baha. And people who are familiar with the Persian will recognize that pairing, which again the Sufis and the mystics have used for centuries. You know, there's Fana, which is the self-annihilation, and then after that is Baha, and Baha is immortality. It's the rediscovery of immortality. So what is that immortality that's rediscovered after self-annihilation? You know, perhaps this is that recognition of one's own consciousness being, let's call it a fragment of the divine self-remembrance. And in that realization, one becomes, one realizes one's own essential immortality. Beyond that, though, Baha'u'llah doesn't describe it, but he says there's another valley beyond that. He says a valley that words can't describe, but it has its own suns and moons and other elements that, you know, that he can't delve into. But apart from that, that mystical work of Baha'u'llah, there's several others which are about to be published and will be available. And I hope this sparks, you know, a lot of conversation and study classes and so forth to try to read these against each other and cross compare them, because it's almost as though it's a sphere. You know, it's not a two-dimensional thing, it's a three-dimensional thing. And so he's giving us different sort of two-dimensional snapshots of it. And it's up to us to try to take these two-dimensional snapshots and try to put them together to see that there's really this three-dimensional object. And other of these works of Baha'u'llah, he even dismisses the whole concept of of valleys and stages, and says, you know, there is a stage of the mystical journey in which stages themselves become nonsensical, in which one sort of start, in which the starting point and the ending point is the same. You know, I am the Alpha and the Omega. I mean, we see echoes of that in previous in other faith traditions as well. So what we're looking at is an evolution of consciousness which ends with this completion of a circle. The circle has to do with this sort of recognition of the of one's true self being connected with the divine self-remembrance, or with God's love for his own essence. What does this have to do with finding common ground? So pulling it back to where we started, I think this is a key, maybe the key, because there's lots of ways that one could find common ground. One can say, well, let's look at it and say four different levels. You know, at the most basic level, one can say, well, let's find common ground, not because we recognize anything in common with each other, but because we recognize that if we don't start working together, we're going to collectively destroy our environment, and none of us are going to survive. None of us are going to survive. So none of us are going to get through the next few centuries unless we just start working together. So at the very lowest level, one can find common ground on purely pragmatic terms, with no spiritual undercurrent, with no even recognition of our oneness as a species. So there's common ground to be had there. Obviously, that's not the common ground that Baha'u'llah is calling us to. At the next level up, one could find common ground, for example, in recognizing that, yes, we're the same species. You know, yes, we share something fundamentally in common that separates us from other creatures on this planet. And on the basis of our common shared humanity, which is purely a physical thing, we can recognize that we must share certain experiences, we must have certain, we must hurt in the same ways and love in the same ways and so forth, and be fundamentally united because we have this bond that we share through our evolutionary history. So that's a second way of thinking about finding common ground, but again, that's a purely physical way of looking at it. A third way of finding common ground would be to say, for example, that, well, we all have a spiritual reality. We all have a soul. The soul is a spark of the divine. Whether we understand that in the sort of traditional, let's say, Cartesian sense of, you know, the soul is my element, you know, my piece of reality, or whether you look at it, you know, as, that's going on to the fourth stage, I guess, but, you know, the idea that we all share a spark of the divine, and that it's through that shared spark of the divine that we can see, you know, in others who may have very different experiences, who may look very differently from us, who may have very different cultural norms than us, to still be able to recognize that there's something that's more fundamental and something that brings us together. That's, you know, unity at a third level. And one might think, well, isn't that enough? Isn't sort of, you know, recognizing that we all have, you know, have a spark of the divine within us, isn't that enough to unite us? Maybe it is, maybe it's not. You know, because what if one says, yeah, well, we all potentially have this spark, but some are like snuffed out candles and others aren't. And so why don't all the lit candles get together and leave all the snuffed out candles, you know, off in the cold? In other words, one can still take the idea that we're sparks of the divine and still use it as a basis for, you know, dividing this group of people from that group of people. So perhaps there's a fourth level of this. And the fourth level has to do with what I was talking about, that sort of ultimate completion of the circle of consciousness, that circle of existence, which involves self-annihilation, which involves that seventh valley that Baha'u'llah talks about, which involves it. And what happens there is a breaking down of the distinction between I and thou. To put it in terms that Martin Buber used, wrote very profoundly about this, you know, the distinction between the I and the thou. That's another way actually of identifying what makes us uniquely human and what differentiates us from the animals, is that we have a subjective universe which is at least as immense as the universe outside. I think it was Rumi who said, "Dost thou consider thyself a puny form when within thee the universe is folded?" It's one of the most ancient ideas of the philosophers and mystics, again, dating from Hermes forward, that the macrocosm and the micro and the macrocosm are mirror images of each other. And by microcosm, he means the human soul, the human reality, the human, our consciousness is itself a world, a universe, and the elements of that universe are reflected in the elements of the greater universe. Again, there's a phrase from the Quran that says, "We shall show them our signs upon the horizons and within their own souls." You know, again, making that sort of distinction or complementary distinction between that which is out there and that which is in here. And the two are complements of each other. So we here we are as individuals. Each of us is a universe. Our consciousness has an interiority which is, let's say, infinitely deep. And what makes us fundamentally different from animals, and what I think gives us this ground, the sort of ability to find common ground in ways that animals can't, is that we can recognize in others that they also possess that interiority. In other words, we can treat other people not as objects, but as themselves knowing subjects and conscious subjects. And the difference between an object and a subject is vast. You know, an object is something which is, you know, you see an object, you see a chair, it's something, you know, it's a physical thing. You interact with it in the sense that you perceive it. But when you perceive something as an object, you don't give it credit for having its own interiority. When you do give it that credit, it becomes not an it, but it becomes a thou. And the relationship between I and thou is what characterizes human relationships as opposed to any other kind of relationships between, you know, human beings and animals or between animals and each other. And it's that sort of, well, it's sort of like deep speaking to deep, you know, it's sort of one infinite well communicating to another infinite well, which is that source, which is different, I think, from, at least in my mind, I'm imagining it's different from just saying, "I'm a soul and you're a soul," you know, and both of these souls come from God. It's something the next level up, because that well, which is infinitely deep, is also infinitely empty. I mean, it goes all the way down, you know, and it also reminiscent of the story of Joseph from the Old Testament. Both Baha'u'llah and Bob have written long commentaries on this, and the story, of course, being that Joseph was I don't know if we have time to sort of recapitulate the whole story of Joseph, but he had a dream about his brothers and his mother and father all bowing down to him, you know, the stars and the sun and the moon bowing down to him, and his brothers got very jealous of this, and so they threw him in a well. And then he was then discovered by some passing Bedouin who then took him and sold him in slavery to Egypt. And the ending was great for Joseph. He ended up, you know, becoming quite rich and powerful, and then inviting his brothers back to Egypt and saving them from a great famine that had overtaken the Holy Land. But all of that just to sort of maybe refresh your memory on the basic outlines of the story. For a really good refresher, I recommend Joseph and the Technicolor Dream Code, yes. Which also has a really good soundtrack. Yeah. and the Pharaoh's Elvis, so you just can't. But anyway, the point of that digression is that the mystics and also the Baba and Baha'u'llah put great emphasis on this idea of the well. The well into which Joseph was cast has this tremendous mystical significance. You know, it's this infinitely deep, infinitely sort of deep, empty space. And within that is actually found everything. So it's a bit of a digression, but the idea is that at this sort of high level, going back to consciousness and going back to the I-thou distinction, it's the ability of deep communicating to deep, of the I communicating with the thou, which is, I think, a truer foundation of human beings coming together. A deeper foundation in the sense that it is truly selfless. It's a kind of collective awareness that all of us are united, not by having, although at some level, I don't want to sort of negate one idea in favor of another. At some level, yes, we all have souls, and at some level, we're all unique beings, and we all relate in that very sort of understandable way. What I'm trying to sort of get at is a somewhat sort of more subtle way of thinking about how we may be connected at an even deeper level. And that is not so much that, you know, we are these individual souls wandering the earth, you know, and we're all trying to find our way home, but rather that there is no I, there is no thou. When you really get down to it, when you strip away all the coverings, what you have is God's love for his own essence. And the entire cosmos, the story of the cosmos from the Big Bang to the present day, and the story of the evolution of the human species and human culture and civilization is the story of God's love for his own essence becoming realized. And when we realize that, it's a truly selfless kind of place that we reach. It's an understanding that all of us are collective centers or loci of the divine, of the divine self-remembrance. And in that sense, we're all truly one. You know, but the oneness that I'm talking about is not a oneness of a whole bunch of individual atoms coming together and saying, hey, we're all similar. It's not the oneness of a group of protons saying, hey, we're all protons, you know, and we all have the same atomic numbers and spins and so forth. It's the oneness of it's the oneness of consciousness realizing that it's one. It's the oneness of our realizing that our true selves are actually no different from the true selves of those other thous that are here in the room and that are here, you know, walking the earth. That all of us are collectively in the process of realizing that primordial love of God for his own essence. So, I guess that's about all, as far as I'm going to take it, is that far enough?